Okay, cool. So, do you know what? This is a video I didn't even really want to do in the first place, but I've been making a playlist for the past, like, 6 to 7 months of just the worst singles and songs that came out throughout 2021, and I kept adding to it, and I thought, you know what, there might be a video idea in it. I haven't written any notes, and this isn't going to be ranked in any particular order because I didn't really want to go back and listen to these songs 4 or 5 times each because I fucking hate all of them. But yeah, this is just a handful of a selection of terrible, terrible songs that dropped in 2021. I'm just going to shuffle this playlist, see what comes up first, and then just tell you exactly why I fucking hate these songs. Okay, so the first song is by an act that I think has possibly the worst, most horrendous, vile, putrid voice in the whole of music right now, and that's Tones and I. And this is the opening song from her debut album, Welcome to the Madhouse, the title track, Welcome to the Madhouse. Welcome to the Madhouse. The life you had is never gonna change. Do you know what? Every time I hear a song from this artist, it really, really confuses me. It's because it's like, it's like the auditory equivalent of an oxymoron, because her music is just this mesh of every generic pop music trope that you can think of, all smashed into one. But at the same time, it's so distinctly terrible and shit, her voice specifically, that as soon as you hear it, you're like, that's Tones and I, that's Tones and I. The reason why it's the opening song from this album is because, like, I wanted to sit down and listen to this album. Pardon me. And I'm like a completionist, so, like, if I start an album, I have to finish it. And there's only a couple of albums I've ever slapped on, and literally from the first song, even if it's from an artist that I actively do not like. Like, if Nav drops an album and I start listening to it, I will finish that. This, I could not get past this first song. Welcome to the Madhouse. And what is this shit about? Welcome to the Madhouse. You've never seen a place like your... This music isn't edgy or weird or... It's like nothing. The only thing that makes it distinctive, it's how fucking horrible the instrumental is, the songwriting is, the voice. This voice is... It could have probably been anything from this album, but because I couldn't get past it, it had to be the first song. I think this one might be a bit of a controversial one because I know this is an artist and an album that a lot of people love. This is from Azaira Shard's latest album, The House Is Burning, an album that I didn't enjoy at all. I didn't think it was the worst fucking thing in the world, but I thought it was just like listening to Vanilla Ice Cream. There was nothing particularly really egregious about the songs on the album. It was just like nothing to me. It was like, it didn't stimulate me really positively or negatively, apart from this one song, and that's What You Said. And the reason I find this song super annoying and frustrating is, one, like, the beat, I actually quite like this beat. Like, I actually actively really enjoy this beat. And the feature, what's her name, Dochi, I thought she did her thing. Like, if this was just her song on its own, I would be like, yeah, cool, I can vibe to this. But the reason this song is on here is specifically for Azaira Shard's contribution. Like, his delivery and vocal tone and inflection sounds like he listened to a bit of Baby Keem and a bit of Playboi Carti and just, like, slowed it down and made it a moody vibe. And the delivery is also so lax. Like, if you're going to do a really, you know, reserved, laid-back delivery, like, you know, a couple of artists do it in different ways. So, you know, like, 21 Savage does it, and the reason he's able to get away with it is because his bars are hilarious and he's witty and he's funny. Or someone like Vince Staples on his last album where, again, it was very, for the most part, kind of removed and not as high energy as some of his other works, but the draw for him is the songwriting. So if you're not witty or you haven't got clever songwriting or you're not penning an intricate story or anything like that, it makes it very boring. And the bars on this, like, when people tell me, like, oh, this is one of the best rap albums of the year, and I hear bars like, and I had too many hoes in my face, I had to cut them off, I've been focused on my one-on-one, and I hope your pussy good as my bank account. What? This is one of the best rap albums of the year? Fuck off. And again, the vocal inflection is it. It's like he listened to Playboi Carti and took a Carti song and lobotomized it. Yeah, it's an interesting one because, like I said, I enjoy the instrumental. I really enjoy the feature. Like, I could listen to this instrumental and vibe. It's chill. It's cool. But it's Azaira Shard's contribution that makes this song terrible. Oh my God. Okay, this one. It could have been so many songs from this fucking album. It's from the DJ Khaled album, Khaled. There were so many horrible fucking piece of shit songs on here. I get big paper, big... That's one of Cardi B's worst ever performances. But this is I Did It with... Who's on it? There's a lot of people. There's DaBaby, there's Post Malone, there's Megan Thee Stallion, and there's Lil Baby as well. The first thing you hear in the song is a sample of Derek and the Dominos' Layla. Horribly interpolated. DJ Khaled has a terrible track record of using classic songs as samples like he did... the song he did with SZA sampled Miss Jackson on the last album. What the fuck was that? But this song specifically, apart from the sample, DaBaby, Megan Thee Stallion, and Post Malone, way below their average. The hook, the I did it, is painfully annoying. Megan Thee Stallion's flows are awkward, which is surprising because she has such like a confident, in-your-face, usually catchy flow as well. DaBaby's verse is... trash. It's just trash. But the frustrating thing is about this song, yeah. Lil Baby, his feature on here is actually sick. And I can't go back and listen to this song just for his feature because it's surrounded by just a mountain of doo-doo. Listen to how Lil Baby goes in. Hey, goddammit, I did it. You don't understand me, I did it. Hey. Chopsticks are like guitar in the air. Stop and take a picture when I'm jumping off a layer. I didn't run it up, it only took a couple years. He tried his absolute hardest. It's like Sisyphus pushing that fucking boulder up that hill. He was trying with his absolute might to save this song from the trenches, but unfortunately he couldn't. Okay, this song. This is one of those songs that blew up, I mean, to me at least, what I learned of this song's existence on TikTok, like a lot of songs, you know, over the past couple years. It's Life Goes On by Oliver Tree. The kind of like Nickelodeon sounding instrumental does nothing at all for me. But like, similarly to the Tones and I song, the voice is so grating and irritating. Life goes on and on and on and on and on and on. It is the most, I have not heard a more annoying hook since Venom came out 3 years ago. I swear on my life. I don't understand why people were hyping up this album, hyping up this artist. This, because this was my first Oliver Tree song I ever heard. It's the only Oliver Tree song I've ever heard so far, because if someone is dropping something like this, it actively puts me off listening to their back catalogue. Apart from the annoying voice, the beat is super simple, which there's nothing wrong with that as well. But again, the lyrics, there's nothing to say about the lyrics whatsoever, but just the voice and the hook get so under my skin. It's like having a parasite living inside my fucking skull. So this is one of the biggest songs of the year, I believe. It's got like billions of streams and shit. It's Stay by the Kid LAROI featuring Justin Bieber. The lyrics are kind of like just generic crooning love song lyrics with just a sprinkling of like toxic behavior. Like, I do the same thing I told you that I never would. I told you I'd change even when I knew I never could. Okay, you're a dick. I know I can't find anyone else as good as you. I need you to stay. I get drunk, wake up, I'm wasted still. What is this a romantic song? It's framed as a romantic song. It's not framed in this way that's like, I'm such a horrible person and, you know, I need to get past my flaws, blah, 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 blah. It's this just like cognitive dissonance where it's like, oh, I need you to stay, but also I'm this fucking horrible person. Some of the lyrics are so cheesy and cringe as well, especially when I'm away from you, I miss your touch. You're the reason I believe in love. It's been difficult for me to trust and I'm afraid that I'm gonna fuck it up. The voice... it's not that good. And the I told you to stay, you know, where he like his breath runs out as he says stay. I don't know if that is probably a stylistic choice, as I'd imagine, but still it sounds trash. But again, it's just such like, bear in mind, obviously probably the majority of people who listen to this song are, you know, quite young people, probably in their teens. And just like the idea of like this relationship dynamic and this formulation of love is so unhealthy. Like Justin Bieber says, ain't no way that I can leave you stranded because you ain't ever left me empty-handed. And you know that I know that I can't live without you. So baby, stay, baby, stay. What is this fucking drug dependency type relationship like that you're romanticizing? It's horrible. And look, aside from that as well, literally about 2/3 of this song is just the repeated hook. The I did this day, no, 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 it's mind-numbing, repetitive, just nothing, bland, plain as shit. Horrible pop music. It's the UK, but this one is hilarious. Okay, this is Boyz by Jesse Nelson featuring Nicki Minaj. Everything about this, if you take out the context of this song with all the controversy surrounding Jesse Nelson with her fallout with members of Little Mix and all the blackfishing stuff as well, which she's been guilty of for years now. This is nothing new. She's not a very likable person. so it makes it a bit easier to hate on this song. Nicki Minaj has been working with some terrible artists, you know, in her past and associating herself with some dodgy people like 6ix9ine and her fucking pedophile partner. I'm not saying Jesse Nelson is on that level, but anyway. But also just the cheek to sample P. Diddy, Bad Boy for Life, a fucking banger, and do nothing creative with the sample whatsoever, and just make it this horribly cutesy, sweet, overproduced R&B/hip-hop collab is just... Ugh. This vocal line that's coming up is like the worst vocal line I've heard all year, I swear my life. Listen to this. When I ride that, yeah. You can tell that there's been so much vocal manipulation on her voice, and not in a kind of way that's so obvious that you can tell it's intentional and it's a stylistic, artistic choice. It's just because her voice isn't very good. You can tell from Nicki Minaj's delivery and her bars that they've probably paid her a shitload of money and she wrote this verse in like 5 or 10 minutes because it's one of Nicki Minaj's worst featured verses, I think, ever. But the reason why I'm grateful for this song is because of the fucking beautiful memes from her Jingle Bell Ball performance that I have fallen in love with. Jingle Bell Ball! Are you ready?
Bad boy, my recipe? Being nice a little boring when you in between the sheets.
So I kind of can enjoy this song on some strange, ironic level. But as an actual song, it's a piece of shit. All right, this one is from an album that was not very good, from Slime Season 2, which had a handful of really, really good songs, like That Go with Meek Mill and T-Shine was like one of my favorite songs of the year. Solid with Drake, I like that song. Ski as well. There's a handful of songs I like. Easily the worst for me is it was so nearly Como te llama, I just wanna know your name. Annoying as shit, but Superstar with Future, what the fuck?
Wanna be a superstar, get a lot of money for physical.
Like, this song feels like a practical joke. Like, the beat is a Wheezy beat and it feels like a parody of a Wheezy beat because he loves using his flutes as well. But this, like, the flute or record or whatever it is sounds so impotent, like whoever's blowing on it is running out of breath as he's playing it. Future's lyrics, again, they sound like a parody of his own lyrics. He's like, I get a lot of money, I'm a superstar, I get a lot of money, fuck these bitches, drive fast cars, smoke drugs. Like, it's that kind of shit. It's the Future is just terrible on this song. Even Young Thug is someone who's usually so consistent, but... You know, here and there he can drop some duds. This is one of the worst Young Thug or Young Thug associated songs I've ever heard. His voice sounds like he's just smoked I don't know how many blunts and he's just out of breath and he's just woken up. Like he's recording from like the foot of his bed as he's just woken from his fucking slumber. Yeah, everything about this song is just so... This is Wheezy and Future and Young Thug, three premier hip-hop artists, and they drop a collab like this. It's just so disappointing. I just expected so much more from these three artists coming together. Ah, this song. This song came out quite recently, actually. By one of the worst artists in all of hip-hop, in my opinion. That's I Don't Really Care by French Montana. A song where he clearly shows us that he really does care. Again, like, first of all, the beat is nothing. His, I don't really care. I don't really care. I mean, it's effortless in the worst way possible. But he opens the song by saying, I don't really care, I make trends and forget about them. Tell me one trend that French Montana has started. I cannot think of a single one. All he does is either ride on the coattails of his featured artist, because 80 to 90% of his songs have features on them because he needs to be carried at all times. Like, how can you name a song, I Don't Really Care, and then the first thing you have to claim is like, I started this shit. Remember me? I started all these trends. No, well, one, you didn't. And two, if you don't really care, why do you have to prove to us that you started all these fucking trends that you say you did? And there's a really awkward bit as well where he can't really fit in a rhyme, something about African visa, and it just sounds just so offbeat and awkward. Yeah, listen to this. What's it like? I ain't do it with an African visa. He literally couldn't even... It's just so lazy. It's so fucking lazy. That song sounds like that and stays the same throughout the entire song. And I'm fine with a beat being really, really simple, someone's flow staying the same. If there's something else that's drawing your attention, if it's the lyrics or... I mean, it has to be the lyrics if you're staying this monotone. And there's nothing. There's literally... It's just him trying to stunt and trying to flex and trying to say he's achieved all these things when he really hasn't. Like, French Montana is one of the most... I still don't understand how French Montana is as big as he is, because he is so incredibly irrelevant. And he says they jerk me up the Grammys next year and bringing 3 to the family. In what? You know, the Grammys are fucking pointless, worthless. You shouldn't really care about the Grammys. But the day that they give French Montana a Grammy is the day this world fucking ends. This song, I've genuinely only heard this song about 2 or 3 times. I heard it the day it came out. I heard it. Yes, I heard it last week when I showed one of my friends who's really into drill this song. And then I listened to it again before I did this video. This is GoldLink with Fire. It's called Culture Clash from his Haram album. And it's one of the worst takes on this genre that I've ever heard in my life. I don't know how many people have heard the song, because I'm going to play a bit and just you're going to just hear how fucking horrible it sounds. Do you know what it sounds like? This is the feature Fire, I believe. I've never heard of this artist, but it sounds like someone's dad heard drill once and he was going through a midlife crisis in the middle of lockdown and was like, I'm going to try and make a drill song. Man says, I could have sold crack to my dad. He's a crackhead. It's not that deep. And outside the context of this song, that would be a hilarious bar. But because everything around it is so trash, I can't even bring myself to laugh at it. So his contribution is terrible. But what GoldLink does... And he does it all over the album as well. It's not just this song. He has this like filter on his voice where it sounds like it's been recorded like over a phone or something. But it sounds, and it's clearly intentional, but it sounds so shit that one, you can't really hear what he's saying. And two, it literally sounds like a mistake, like an audio editing mistake. You know, oh man, if anyone like... You have to be a certain way to one, do drill, two, do it well, or pay homage to it well. And this is just horrible. It's like GoldLink clearly heard, like, one of his boys played him a UK drill tune once, and he was like, yeah, that's tight, nigga, I want to try that shit on my next album. And he spat this, and he heard, like, 2 drill songs in his life. Oh, this is the last song. Okay, so the last song on this list is, again, one of the biggest artists in the world, unfortunately. One of the biggest songs, Jesus Christ, that's depressing. One of the biggest songs of 2021 is Bad Habits by Ed Sheeran. Do you know what? I knew that this song was going to be terrible when I saw the cover art with his fucking eyeshadow and the vampire teeth. I knew it was shit from then. You know, I have not been a fan of it. There's probprobably, in his like 10-year career, there's probably 2 to 3 Ed Sheeran songs max that I can say I genuinely like. One... The reason being is, his production and approach to making pop music is just so cynical to me, because it's just so formulaic and generic and nothing stands out about it. But two, his songwriting can be painfully either basic, cringy, or portray him as not a very nice person. This instrumental, it's like, I don't know, it's like he heard After Hours by The Weeknd and was like, I kind of want to do that, but I need to make it as accessible to as many people as possible. So he like mashed that with a fucking Flow Rider beat from 2009. And some of the lyrics are horrible. He says, falling over everything to reach the first time spark. It started under neon lights and then it got dark. The thing that cracks me up, I've never seen this before until just now. Underneath the Spotify lyrics on some songs, it has like a storyline for some artists. And what it says about this song, it says, I spent a month making a lot of mad tunes, and this was one of the mad ones. Bad habits, a mad tune. What is your definition of a mad tune? Like, there's nothing mad about the lyrics. There's nothing mad about the voice. There is nothing mad about the instrumental. It's the most bland, ice-flavored instrumental that you can imagine. It's like Ed Sheeran drops every time Ed Sheeran like drops a big single. It's the same thing. It's just, like I said, it's a cynical approach. Ed Sheeran is, like, to me, like the DJ Khaled of pop music, where when he drops, I know, like, because I've come so accustomed to it now, I know exactly the formula for what it's going to be. It's either going to be him doing a sappy ballad with his fucking guitar pedal and the lyrics are soppy as shit, or it's a generic club banger with the most freaking text-to-speech basic lyrics imaginable that literally everyone can relate to it, or he wants everyone to relate to it, and it makes it just so nondescript. Yeah, okay, I don't want to listen to any more of these tunes. I don't want to think about any of these tunes. I want to leave them in 2021. There were a few more, actually, songs on that playlist, but I didn't want to do more than 10 because I really sat and listened to these 10 songs two or three times before I made this video, so I had shit to say about them because I tried to store them in the back of my fucking memory. But yeah, I hope we will get some shit in 2022, of course. Yeah, those are some of my worst songs of 2021. Let me know in the comments what do you think some of the worst songs of last year are. Make sure to like, subscribe, dong the bell, and I will see you next time. Jesus Christ, those songs are shit.